ladies and gentlemen, and in particular students representing the Generasi Millennium. I'm really trying to present to this younger generation on what's going on today. And I predict that what we are facing today is maybe an unbelievable event called global disarray. So instead of the simple disorder that we had suffered since 1911, I think we are entering a new era where a lot of strategies for development, including business development, have to be really understood within this new context emerging recently. I was in the crisis. I was called by President Suharto in the months of September 1997, just as the Thai baht crisis hit us and created later on a two-year-long Asian financial crisis. Indonesia was hit the worst. But as you realize, the whole crisis spread out to South Korea, to China, to Taiwan, to the Philippines, and so on. We lost a large portion of our GDP. Indonesia, for example, lost approximately probably 60% of our GDP. The cost of crisis is estimated to be about maybe $50 billion at that time. South Korea, Thailand, Malaysia also faced the same problem. Fortunately, Malaysia at the time undertook an unbelievable initiative, really, instead of going to IMF at the time, which is the case of most of us. And unfortunately today, we are hearing that Argentina, Turkey, many countries, South Africa, are facing almost the same problem like what we suffered at that time. Hopefully, this time around, so many lessons that we learned in the past can be used to face whatever that will be with us in the coming months and years ahead. This is the situation as I see it. When I came to the attention of many in Indonesia, and I was called by President Suharto, later on, because he resigned in the month of May 1998, and I was already ambassador to the United States, instructed by him to shuttle diplomacy between the United States and Indonesia. Of course, you have IMF, World Bank, and so on in Washington DC at that time. I was then asked by, instructed by President Habibie to continue. 1 year after reformasi, a very turbulent political situation, a simple, really, rupiah crisis re-emerged as a crisis of the whole banking and financial system. We lost hundreds of banks and insurance companies and so on. And after that, he was, of course, not supported to continue. Then came President Abdul Malik, who asked me to continue in the United States at the time. And by the time I finished my 3.5 years of stint in Washington, D.C., trying to really mediate with the United States, with IMF, with World Bank, of what we can do together to avert further disaster for Indonesia is currently the number 4 largest population in the world. Our archipelago, extending from Papua to Aceh, is equal to 3.5 time zones, which is really Moscow to Dublin, and north to south is equal to Berlin to Rome. And I draw their attention that about maybe 40% of the world shipping traffic has to pass us. So a stable Indonesia is really a requirement for everybody, you know, in the world, in consideration of further development and growth. That was the situation at the time. So by the time I finished it, I was asked by President Megawati to continue. It took me 3.5 years to work together in the cabinet to really initiate the recovery of the economy from minus 18% of GDP we suffered at that time, and a rating of something like CCC-. We suffer the indignity of Standard and Poor rating of about CCC-, and a spread of something like 2,000 basis points on top of the United States Treasury Fund. By the time I left in 2004, the first fierce general election in Indonesia, it was just a B minus, single B minus. And still, I think, a spread of 700 basis points. So once you are hit by a crisis, it took such a long time for a huge country like Indonesia, in terms of geography and demography, to recover. Now, unfortunately, as we are here, we again being challenged by a problem which is more difficult, I see, in the future. So instead of a keynote address, what I would like to do today is actually a business briefing. So please bear in mind that a lot of the statistics I use here, some diagrams and so on, is really with a consideration that we should put many of our development strategy, not only for countries, but also for businesses, within this context of really what happened in the world today. After the first stage of the post-World War, Second World War, we understand at that time you have the understanding of major countries as well as those countries that really decolonized and so on that we would like to develop. And at that time, supreme in consideration was the so-called ideal politic. We believe that rules-based multilateral principles should be built up. We started with the formation of United Nations. After that, we follow with IMF, World Bank, GATT, General Agreement of Tariff and Trade. We initiated so many steps at a time. And eventually, because of that, we enjoy what we call as globalization, especially since the 60s and the 70s. Globalization involves three elements. One is that we have institutions. For example, for dispute settlements in trade, especially for us, commodity traders. Every time we're hurt by the unbelievable volatility in commodity prices, then we attract the attention of GATT, of IMF, that they should come to our assistance. Because we suffer, we see a lot of problems in balance of payment, and so on. So negotiations was really the key element in this institution. We tried to negotiate, we used diplomacy to solve problems. This was what happened at that time. And very popular in geopolitics was the method that we used at the time, we call it the non-zero-sum approach to problem. This is where we consider problems in the world as a public goods to be solved by all of us together. And we should insist, that's what we believe at that time, on a rules-based system. But since 9/11, you do have really unbelievable initiatives, actions, sometimes military actions at that time, to solve issues in certain areas in the world, like Middle East, for example, at the time, and North Africa and so on. Really, we saw the beginning of the so-called consideration of balance of power. Instead of ideal politics, you move into real politics at the time. And after that, we see that you have really the unbelievable conviction that we can try to solve world problems not only by diplomacy, which is considered to be passé at the time, but some insist that maybe we should move on to regime change if necessary. And this was done, as you see, in many countries in the Middle Eastern region. So we, at that time, saw the beginning of threat of violence being used in international relations. We begin to move out, actually, from the need multilateral, principle-based, rules-based, based on negotiation, post-World War, to a real political situation. We begin to see a world disorder at the beginning of that. Major powers decided at that time, see, especially because many of the major powers, the established ones, consider that other problems begin to rise in their midst. One is, of course, the rise of the rest, in particular China, in particular the Asian newly industrialized economies at the time coming up. So this is a problem for many of the developed countries, as I will indicate to you in the statistical tables. So That was a period when we begin to see disorder arising in the world at the time. You still have remnants of respect to the ideal polity. We still honor WTO, as a matter of fact, at that time, after negotiation. Please show the kind of exercise of the negotiations that we did. To move out from the very protectionist neo-mercantilist system of the one that you know, emerged as a cause for the First World War at the time and the Second World War. We negotiate. By the time we move through this almost a decade-long Uruguay era, we come to the decision that we should set up a WTO. And globalization, because of this, was moving very fast at the time. But we saw the last exercise we tried under Doha Round failed by 2016. And the reason was always blamed on the rise of the rest, which is creating really new problems, you know, because our competition is getting tougher for the developed countries. So that's the reason why at that time, not only in the geopolitical side, but also on the geo-economic side, we have more and more pressures being used. So the rules-based system is being really criticized as one of the problems which causes a lot, you know, of issues in the world economy. Right? So, no wonder by 2015-2016, Doha failed to reach any agreement, and that was the first time we considered to be the beginning of the world disorder in the, on the geo-economic side. Go back again, So, from this order, this is the problem of today, we begin to see that a lot of problem emerge from the developed countries. Actually, you have really the interest politics emerging first time, of course, Brexit. Actually, Brexit preceded President Trump by almost 2 years. The pressure at that time to get out from Europe and the rise of populism in Europe, and which is really getting worse now, as you see. So, we are actually moving into a disarray. Because instead of the multilateral, based on principles and rules based, today we see the beginning of case by case self-interest political maneuvers based on simple politics and personalities. And it is done not only in the geopolitical realm, but also in geoeconomics. So it's getting more difficult, as I see it, to combine agriculture and industry, which is of course the theme, you see, of today. We would like very much, as digitalization revolution is getting you know, more important in the world today, we would like very much to combine Industry 4.0 and what we call as PA, precision agriculture. So the problem is the market is not that easy anymore. This is the situation. Because President Trump, for example, the battle cry is of course America first. Let's make America great again. And of course, you remember the reaction of China, of Europe. I can really go to many details about that later on. But this is really a situation where, instead of the confidence-building measure, we are moving on one-on-one, zero-sum deal-making on specifics. It is not the principles that we discuss in WTO anymore. The insistence is not for bilateral. And sometimes it's almost like a poker game, somebody is bluffing and so on, and you have really unbelievable words using diplomacy for the first time. Really unbelievable words that I rarely at that time tolerate way back during the crisis and so on in Indonesia. So today we have actually major powers rivalry. Instead of a simple rise of the rest, in which China is considered probably by United States at the time as just a strategic competitor. Today, as we see it, it's beginning to shift into a situation whereby you have a lot of accusation like that this rise of the rest, unimpeded, abusing globalization or whatever they call it, you see. And because Doha Round broke down, the belief that is what we have today is not a rivalry, And not a competition, not a strategic competition anymore. This is really a strategic rivalry. So it is really now more and more maneuver, bilateral insistence on specifics like cars, or like you know, food, non-food agriculturals, and so on. Everything is broken down into items. And this is the situation which probably can be called as disarray. Because at the same time, we see this resurgence of nationalism in the world. You do have not only nationalism of the left type, the usual one, like we have seen in Asia or in Africa, in Latin America, but we have also the right type of nationalism rising, for example, in Europe and in the case of migrants. And really, I mean, you can just go on to the mass media to check what is going on. So, what we are seeing today as we assembling in this seminar, in this world of disarray, what you mean is that you don't have anymore. You are not sure anymore about what kind of vision do we have, what kind of mission that we would like to see, you know, in the world order. And then goals. Who will determine the goals for all of us in the world, based on rules-based principles, based on the approach of multilateralism? So we are not sure anymore. And in the structural, functional stage, which we use to, you know, as a base for discussion of strategy, we really begin to see the destruction of institutions. You remember the Twitter, President Trump attacking WTO, to our fear that this is going to be really go all the way to the destruction of maybe WTO and many other institutions in the world. He is really very dissatisfied with what is going on during those decisions. I will indicate to you in terms of statistics. But also the organization, management style, and so on. With this kind of chaos, I believe that a lot of management theory probably is not only have to be reviewed, but you have to use it very carefully. Management theory that we teach in the School of Business, in this kind of you know, new normal, that is the terminology, really a case of the disarray. You really have to be, as I will show to you in statistics. And we even have problems in the behavioral side. And the three elements, actually, this is what really, after the Second World War, we taught in the universities, every university in the world. We believe that you must have a consistency, high consistency, strong consistency between the three elements. You must be clear with what is your mission, for example, in business. What is the sense of mission that you would like to instill to your manpower in business and so on. And then you then devise strategy, you use institutions, you create by using organization theory, management theory, what kind of business model you are going to pursue, and so on. And then because of that, of course, you have a code of conduct. It will be decided in accountancy, in statistics, in business intelligence, and so on. You do have protocol for what we call as a code of conduct in business. But this is the situation that we are facing today, and that's the reason why, instead of Gino Pedres, what I would like to do today is actually to draw the attention especially of the millennials in this room. That what we have is page 5. Actually, several years ago, halaman 5, actually, sometimes ago we already saw a study done by my former assistant, but who is now a professor at Cornell University. He already warned that this is what's going to happen. If globalization increasingly leads to imbalances in the world, global imbalances, which is of course blamed by people in the developed countries, unfortunately, as a situation whereby the rise of the rest is going to be more difficult competition on their side in this expanding world trade and so on. So this is the list of what we should expect. What is going to happen, that you will have this number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4. I think you can use this later on for discussion. But because of this, page 6, now this is what I saw from the first statement after the election, coming from President Trump. By the time he planned for the first trip abroad, then you have this unbelievable two statements by his advisors, McMaster and Gary Cohn. The world is surely not a global community anymore, but an arena where nations, non-governmental actors, and business engage and compete for an advantage. We bring to this forum unmatched military, political, economic, cultural, and moral strength. Rather than deny this elemental nature of international affairs, we embrace it. So this was the base for that battle cry, America First. Let's make America great again, as I see it. So after 7 years of living through page 7, through gut negotiation, ending with the creation of WTO, we hope at that time we have a great hope that we will continue globalization. Instead, we have the first crisis in Doha round, which later on followed by Brexit, later on followed by many more, you know, self-initiative spreading out all over the world. But the reason, according to Wall Street, is page 8. This is the problem. Globalization is hurting us, according to the United States. And three in particular, the one factor which is really hurting us is coming from Germany, Japan, and China. And of course today, we are facing a problem as Pak Trump is in the NATO conference. Of course, he is blaming Germany and many other countries, members of NATO. You promised us, he reminded all, that every NATO member will contribute at least 2% of their GDP for defense. How come Germany, the one that enjoys surplus for such a long time under globalization, under the 70 years of globalization which we advocated and we initiated under leadership, how come Germany spent only 1.2% of GDP for defense? And, you know, he complained to France, so his keyword in NATO is burden sharing from now on. And of course, after meeting with Kim Jong-un in Singapore, he also stated that no more armed war exercise because it is costing too much. So it's almost like he is demanding that also burden sharing be done on our side in Asia. So, you can see from here that this is really becoming his battle cry, that America be mistreated by globalization. We have a lot of problems like the breach of the intellectual property, which was included actually in the Doha round negotiation and so on. But come to think that this is, you can see from statistics. Okay, go to have. This was happened in 2008. I went back to this data, look at this. America suffered a trade balance like this, and you guys, Japan, China, and then Euro, Germany is not included as yet at the time. But this is what happened. And this is also what happened in current account. So, at that time, you remember the first pressure was on Japan. Quota decided to invest to really set up your factories in the United States. Toyota was forced by quota, by really the insistence that you have to produce your car in America at that time. And of course, depending on the American defense system in Japan, Japan had no choice at the time but to really follow that. But you can see from here that in terms of GDP growth, look at this. This was the beginning that was used by China. The first trade surplus in China was used under Prime Minister Deng Xiaoping, and later on continued by Prime Minister Xi Jinping at the time to push the growth of China, and this is what happened. You know, 10% while America is just like this. So you can see from statistics that indeed there was a base of this sentiment rising in America because they complain about the hollowing out of the industrial system in America. They lost hundreds of factories and thousands of employment because of this unbelievable competition in the world, according to them. Because we open our market as the biggest economy in the world, but you still use non-tariff barriers and whatever at that time. And Look what happened later on. By 2018, by the time President Trump came into power, look what happened. You know, and Germany is not mentioned here, of course, but Euro, to a large extent, the surplus is Germany. This is to a large extent Germany. Look at this. United States complained, and that's the reason why the battle cry of President Trump at the time and his ministers were, can you do something, China? Like, for example, let's reduce this you know, deficit by several hundred billion US dollars, something like that. Or else. So this was the beginning, of course, of pressures, you know, that under the theme of America First, and let's make America great again. And look what happened to GDP. Did what? Immediately you feel the pressure. See, on China, growth is slowing down from 10 to 6. And I think this trend is going to continue as the threat of trade war is increasing between the United States and America, and it's spreading onto Europe and so on. You know, in terms of not just simple products, but would you believe that the situation now is moving toward really the battleground of cars, automotive. Automotive is together with airplanes and ships, really are the most important manufactured products in the world. And the United States is threatening Asia, Europe, and so on, that anything that you, that we import from you, see, will have to face a tariff wall of maybe 20 to 25%, something like that. So this is what is going on today. Unfortunately, as we show here, that indeed statistics really proven the case, something like that. But just because of that, do we have to go to this trend of disarray, right? You know, moving out from the symbol disorder, which was caused by more or less 9/11 at that time. Now it is becoming really a burden for all of us, because somebody is putting it on the geo-economic side, not stopping on the geopolitical side. And as a matter of fact, you're beginning to see the combination of both problems, as I see it. So this is the situation as I see it today. This is going to continue unabated. And the reason is so many, but most important is, of course, page 13. If you use a price purchasing parity, and of course, GDP per capita have to be multiplied by the size of the population, suddenly United States saw the statistics that by year 2017, China began to bypass in terms of price purchasing parity. With a population of 1.3 billion, and a middle class of maybe about 40%, any startup in China will easily, you know, take off using the international trading system, you know, as we had at the time. So, United States increasingly complained that this is what's going on, despite the fact that actually the unbalanced situation in the world continues. Inequality, for example, between the low income. Look at this, and this is of course the high income, and this is the world GDP by price purchasing parity. Actually, most of the GDP is still enjoyed by probably just 20% of the world population in the developed countries. Because so many of us, you see, still suffering in this situation, as indicated by poverty in South Asia, in Africa, in some of the Pacific Islands, and so on. But despite this, they begin to see that we suffer because of globalization and because of the competition is getting worse in terms of division of labor in the world. Of course, we should not complain, because we are going to be the best for many labor-intensive technologies. But still, what they see that cumulatively, the spread of these labor-intensive and resource-based industries to the developing areas like us is finally increasing the power of the rise of the rest, creating strong momentum. Okay, we go to the next page after this. So, this is at the base of what happened at the time. And of course, what we would like to see is how to survive in this kind of misery. And of course, we we will still would like to see the interface, not just between the academia, the industry, but more importantly is page 15. We would like to see an interface between the so-called precision agriculture, which is made possible now by digitalization of agriculture, from the choice of seed to the starting point of planting, the distribution of water. You can use everything. You see, drones, you have your GMO, you can really use technology. So we are using now the word of precision agriculture. And of course, what happened is we would like very much to combine the industry 4.0, where you have latest technology, even in the labor intensive industry, combined with this to push growth even faster. But then the problem, where is the market? That is the situation today. Because America insists not using the WTO multilateral principle or rules-based anymore. It's going to be one-on-one. So the maneuvers is going to be done by way of politics and personality sometimes. So you should read in Financial Times and Bloomberg Business Week statements by Macron, by Merkel, by Trudeau, by Xi Jinping, by Kyung and then Abe. The situation is really so confusing for me because I have to follow Twitter communication as well as statements. Yeah, because you don't have the world order anymore. It's disappearing very fast. Beyond this order to a disarray, I see. And it is taking place on the institutional side, and on the normative side, on the institutional side, and on the behavioral side. So this is the situation as I see it. We actually would like to see the combination between the two to grow in tandem, to speed up the process of transformation in our country and so on. This is the usual dream of economic development, which I studied a long time ago. I'll move on. But this is the problem. As you will see in statistics today, we are still, many of us are still in the position of price taker in terms of commodities. And on the import side, we are also on the price taker side. When we try to sell rubber, chocolate, coconut, or whatever, see, we are really price taker. You are facing an oligopsony. By the time you try to buy anything from the developed countries, you are facing oligopoly. On both sides, you are actually in the position of price taker, very difficult to budget. And then the futures trading is decided by countries like, for example, UK. You discuss about whatever in mining, you have to really watch London metal market. You're in a commodity market, you have to watch NYMEX, New York Mercantile Exchange, for example, for guidance. When I was coordinating minister, I have a pavilion full of computers next to my residence at the time just to watch what is going on in terms of currency, movement of bonds, prices, and so on. So, because you have only four markets in the world. You have a commodity market, that's the orders, and you have equity market, you have property market, and you have currency market. By the time you come to currency market, this is what I realize. It's maybe 5 to 7 trillion per day, the activities of the currency market where they sell every currency. But 80% of that consisted of United States dollar. Dollar is very important, so I try to really convince my American friends, but the reason of why we try to fight with export driven economies is because we have to earn dollar. Because you accept only dollar in the world market when we buy anything in terms of import. So don't blame us why we try to really earn as much as possible, but you suffer the indignity of price taker position for such a long time. And look at this. How long did it go? Go on. Now, this is what happened. The movement of commodities in the world is not decided by us. It was decided by business cycle in the West. And this has happened already for about 200 years. We complained to IMF that a special window should be open for us. Now, because sometimes we suffer this really rapid movement like this. There is no way for us to escape this. So this business cycle, peculiar business cycle of in the commodity market is persisting up to now. Okay, have a look. Difficult. Look at this. This is what happened during the Asian financial crisis. At that time, when I entered the cabinet, when I was called by President Suharto at that time to Paris to discuss about what is going to be the, he asked me three questions. Number one, what happened in Thailand? So I have to explain about Thailand crisis. The second one, can it happen here? The third one, which is more difficult, for the most difficult, how much time do we have? So I start, floating the idea of capital outflow by using the Thai statistics. And I indicated to President Suharto, excuse me, Baba, you probably have only 5 to 6 months before we will hit the crisis, something like that. So at that time, when the crisis took place in Asia, finally the crude oil price went down like this. And because of this, suddenly this is reflected in everything, in food, reflected also in non-food agriculture, in metal, everything together with this. But of course, for commodity producers like us, you suffer a lot because of this. Look what happened after this. By the time I left the cabinet, it was like this. 2004, I still able to pull one of the freest elections in Indonesia, joined by more than 100 political parties as we democratize the system. A direct election for president. Only 9 political parties survived. I was struck by this situation. The price of crude oil increased again. As a result, we have better price for coal. We have better price for natural gas in Indonesia at the time. So suddenly, the balance of payment is looking very well at that time. But look what happened. Immediately, this is translated also to food. Immediately, this is also translated into non-food agriculturals. And whatever index that you use in the commodity market, dollar, sterling, euro, it is the same trend. So every time the West suffer cycles, which will be indicated in the price of energy, crude oil, LNG, and so on, immediately it will be reflected in food as well as non-food agriculturals. So, for example, when the price of crude oil increased, next, like this one. By the time it was 2005, if I'm not wrong, 2008, it was like this. Because the Asian crisis is over already at that time. And then suddenly, everything that commodities that have methanol and ethanol, just like this. So suddenly, wheat, grain, sugar, you see, because it can be translated into biodiesel. You look at this. And non-food agriculturals also. So this is what happened. The volatility, and I believe that not only about volatility, as long as you are a price taker, you are condemned to a forever low commodity price of the world because the terms of trade. When you compare manufactured products and agricultural products, my students say to me, by checking data, that there is no technology content, but in rubber, in palm oil, look at cars. It's even worse than your Volkswagen of 20 years ago. You cannot break it down anymore, the engines and so on. Because the technology content of cars today is unbelievable. So in terms of trade, we are suffering. The technology content of cars and the incoming cars, the driverless Tesla and so on, I think this is going to be even worse for us as digitalization moving in to many parts of the industry in the world while commodity has no technology content. At the most that you discuss is the GMO for food, right? So this is what is happening. The volatility of the commodity market is something that you just cannot control. See? And on top of that, we are suffering really terms of trade, which is really not supporting the kind of development plan that we have. So this is what happened, and you just go on with the statistics daily. You can use the futures trading for metal, for example. But look what happened. When, page 22, when see, we have the subprime crisis hit the United States and it spread all over the world at that time, the subprime crisis, which is of course triggered by the so-called toxic asset, and I don't want to give a lecture about that. But suddenly I was called at the time to as far as Stockholm, Warwick, and so on, to discuss what is the difference between the subprime crisis and the Asian financial crisis at that time. So by that time we have to see, you know, that finally this is what happened. This is, we have to see this. I share with them, look at this. Suddenly, as really what happened during the crisis, the Asian financial crisis, the price of crude oil went down. Because of the slowing down of the economy in the developed countries, it became like this. But then this is registered also. And the price of agriculturals, non-food agriculturals at that time. So very volatile. There's nothing that we can do. Really, in terms of this business cycle, engineered mostly by what happened in the Western countries, developed countries. Now this is the situation in 23, this is the latest of June. And of course, Trump is complaining. United States is facing a midterm by November. And he already stated that he would like to see the crude oil market is just like this. But instead of that, you know, this morning I checked, I think it's already about $78 per barrel for, if I'm not wrong, Brent. And West Texas Intermediate is around something like $73 per barrel. So you could imagine for countries that subsidize fuel, and of course, you know, for Trump, it's going to be a very difficult summer as people travel suddenly, it's $3 per gallon, something like that. And he demanded that something be done, and he forced Russia, Saudi Arabia, and so on to add, you know, more production into the market so that it will be maintained. So this is the situation as I see it as today. I don't know whether he's going to succeed or not, but this triangular game between Putin controlling oil and Saudi Arabia, Prince Salim, you know, controlling oil, and Trump pressuring each other to stabilize the price of crude, it is just for his own sake at the time, you know, because he would like to continue for a second term, something like that. So geo-economic and geopolitics, it's now mixed. Page 34, look at this. This is the picture of the 100 top companies in the world. For the first time, the rise of the rest is demonstrated in the rise of companies from our side. The red ones are really companies from Asia. And if you compare this list of companies with the one in Financial Times or Dow Jones and so on, you suddenly realize that this is actually the picture that they are using. That so many companies, you see, is really thriving during globalization. And that's the reason why the threat is not just to economies, but also to countries, to companies, as I see it. So what's going to be the consequence of this? The consequence, as I present here, I think this will be a crisis of modeling. Now, look at this, the reason is 26. I think we cannot rely anymore to the model of economic development, of business development in the past. Cannot do that. Look at this Kondratiev cycle. Do you realize that the development of this technology, mostly coming from the West because of the research development and engineering expenditure that they keep spending, and that's the reason why United States would like to stop, you know, really the flow of this kind of technology to us. By using our momentum in commodity, for example. Yeah. Because this is what happened. We are really moving toward info bio nano. It's reflected in the triple T, in transportation, in travel, yeah, and in telecommunication. We have unbelievable possibility of disruptive technology. 5G, for example, where your refrigerator, your oven, your garage are going to be transmitting message to you, so it's becoming like Internet of Things, right? Be careful about the pollution of that radiation in your house at that time, it's going to be increased by how many fold, I believe. But they are really approaching IoT, this 5G. And that's the reason why Samsung didn't sell last year. They lost about 10%, right, already. Nobody bought telephone anymore, handphone, smartphone anymore, because they are waiting for 5G now. And by 5G, those towers, it's not going to be useful because they are going to use low Earth orbital satellites. So the world is going to be connected by hundreds of low Earth orbital satellites. You can really access, instead of me going with iPad and checking in the hotel, you know, hey, what is your Wi-Fi, something like that. 2 years from now, it's going to be instant everywhere. In my car, in my bathroom, in everything. So, the fourth industrial revolution is coming. That's the reason why they call it Industrial 4.0. And in agriculture, we move to this. We move to genetic engineering. We move to the precision agriculture and so on. You discuss about drip irrigation. Instead of irrigation for rice, which is requiring 1 ton of rice, requiring maybe about 2 tons of water, by using GMO, which I saw in Monsanto when I was ambassador twice, and I was invited by them. And also the possibility of using ethanol, and food, see, for future fuels, something like that, instead of just discussing about the battery, lithium, cobalt. So we are also discussing now the possibility, you see, of further use of commodities in agriculture for really supporting future demand for energy, for example. And the cycle is getting shorter. You see, this is the first industrial revolution. It's getting shorter. So we don't know what is going to happen beyond disruptive technology, and whether industry 4.0 on our side will help the case, you see, for us, as the United States is really blocking market for everything coming to the United States, coming from Industry 4.0. Okay, we can continue. So this is a neat picture of what's supposed to happen. Once upon a time, when I studied development economics, this is what what was promised by many economists, that it's going to be like this. You start from a pre-industrial stage of $300 per capita, you move to early industrialization, then you become the Asian niche, you just go like this, and it's an S-curve. And of course, we know very well that anybody who study mathematics, that in every cycle like this, you face an inflection point, right? That is the time when really you can skip with your car, something like that. So we have to be very careful for each stage, because you have limited growth for each stage. This is what we study at the time. We believe that you cannot really drive it faster. I can move to the picture. You cannot. Everybody know the ideal from the Marxist side, for example. They say, no, we can accelerate. We can accelerate development. If you have really the right political strategy, for example, wipe out the whole bourgeoisie, something like that. Yeah. But what we learn is, you cannot do that. Each stage has to be completed before you move to another one. You cannot do a fast sprung. But now, with the spread through globalization of knowledge, of technology, of even imagination, most expensive knowledge is actually imagination. It is spreading in the world through social media. So apps is spreading. once you have a breakthrough, you have hundreds of new apps, for example, also hundreds of new apps disappear. It's not moving along the same curve anymore. It's not going to be a simple shift of the curve. It's really spread out, you see, on top and on the downside of this curve. So there is a possibility that instead of acceleration or even maybe a delayed industrialization, many some of us who cannot find the best way to get out in this distant race situation, the best way to get out, how do you do that? What kind of strategy do you have to devise? Not only for countries, but also for business. How do you survive with your business in this kind of situation? Otherwise, what happens is you get hit by a crisis. And so many big companies are disappearing today. Have a look into Dow Jones, a picture of what happened to many established companies in the past, many of them degenerate. The latest one, do you believe? It happened to GE. It happened to GE. It happened to Toshiba. And what about IBM? And what about, this is the problem. So, so many companies in the world are going to suffer, you see, because they fail to adapt. And it's not just countries, it's going to be also company by company, commodity by company, real estate by real estate, you know, cities by cities, you know, see it. As a matter of fact, the governor of Bangkok, Sukumaran Parindran, a very close friend of mine, he shared with me at one conference, he said, Jatan, the international relations in the future is not decided by nation states anymore. It's going to be decided by big metropolitan cities like us. By Jakarta, by New Delhi, you know, by Shanghai, by Tokyo, not anymore by nation state, because urbanization 5 years from now is going to be maybe 80% in Indonesia. Yeah, so this is the situation, and this is the neat picture also of Chavari Sirkan. When I studied about structural change, this is what the idealized model. You start from agriculture, services, industry, you move by steps, and then you end up. Hopefully one day, if you can accelerate that, you come to this. Services is going to be foremost, and after that, industry and agriculture, okay? This is GAN. This neat sequencing is GAN. Okay, perfect, finish. So this is the problem. Even with the model, with the old model, under the tutelage of WTO, under the rules-based system, all these Latin American countries suffered going to nowhere, folks, for 60 years. Nobody of them can get out from this middle-income trap. Nobody. Even China, at that time, when I picked this up, you know, the data, you have this, this. No wonder. I think last year when we had the plenum of the Communist Party, and I was in Hong Kong at the time, for the Asian Insurance Summit, where we discussed the problem of aging in the world at the time. President Xi Jinping really presented a 3.5-hour speech, which is usually just about half an hour at the time. And the decision of the plenum at the time is to appoint him for life, and his speech is adopted as a doctrine. On the other side, Putin is elected for a new term, he will be there for 6 years. On the other side, we have Erdogan, we have Trump, you know, and so on. So suddenly, the whole situation as I see it in the world today is putting many of us in the developing countries, with this kind of threat. That so many of us, including companies, who cannot adapt to this situation in this array under threat of shorter technological wave of Kondratiev cycle, is that so many of them are just to be here. And of course, this is what we don't want to see in Indonesia. We would like to get out, you see, because by year 2050, yeah, Indonesia is going to be still number 5 population in the world. 60% of population is going to be working age. So employment is a must, and we should really aim at 7% per annum of growth. Less than that, you will create a lot of problems, I see. So this is Asia. For me, we have the biggest market in the world. Whatever that we can do in terms of startup and so on, immediately it can be used by a big market, more and more urbanized, more and more in middle class, actually. But then, you see, because of this threat, the rise of the rest, the developed country began to re-erect walls. They want to stop WTO, you know, there's so many things. So it's going back to almost like mercantilism, as I see it. So look at this situation in Indonesia. This is the problem in Indonesia. We would like very much to really go out from the middle income trap and just to go from the present $5,000 to that edge of $30,000 when we have to discuss about how to get out further from the middle income trap. You need about maybe 28 years still. So this is going on, and then after this, here's more. Yeah, okay. Now, so this is the problem. I said, no, 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 Many of us have to maybe check the situation that this is already a warning signal. That so many of us, this is of course what happened. Fragility, state fragility has to be included. Next page. Look at this, you have high alert, you have very high alert. So you can see, if you want to start, for example, precision agriculture in Kenya or in Nigeria, because what happened is China is not trying to move farms to West Australia, to Brazil, to Africa and so on, because they want to use the coastal area in China for industrialization for zero. Because with the population moving to 1.3 billion and prematurely aging, look at this, China is prematurely aging. Here you are. Japan is not only aging but also shrinking. And this is Korea. By year 2050, those above 60 years is going to be really a problem. But Indonesia, Malaysia, we are really slowly aging. You still have a lot of opportunity to be used. Whatever that you can do in the agriculture, in industry, and how do you really synchronize the two sectors. And forget about the old model of really that meat type of, you know, staging and so on. We just forget it. Maybe what we have to discuss later on, how will it really come to a new strategy in the face of this situation. Finally, the developed country knows about you much better than we do. Page 46. They have mapping of everything. They know what is in the land, in the sea, in the air. They are controlling the cyberspace. They are combining artificial intelligence, big data, blockchain. They know what's going on. Much better, for example, if you try to find the best farm areas in Africa, they can really point it just like that by using Google and so on. So, our knowledge of this is not that good in many developing countries. Knowledge about the spatial dimension of the government. And you can imagine, you see, when you translate that to issues like Indonesia and Malaysia, which I put here, Indonesia is like this in page 47. We are the largest archipelago in the world, so Moscow to Dublin, Berlin to Rome. There's a lot of opportunity that we can use, you see, in the seas for producing food of the future, whatever, I don't know. See? But this is Malaysia also on the side, the map of Malaysia. And everybody have to pass through this area. Look at this, the traffic of container, the traffic of oil. This is of oil, of gas. This is of iron, right? This is LNG, and then this is iron ore and coal. So everybody have to pass the Indian Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, and the South China Sea. Of course, what we would like is all the countries in between this big body of water are really modernizing, stabilizing. Because you could imagine if one of us become like Somali, what's going to happen to the traffic of 5 trillion passing through South China, for example. So this is the challenge of us. We really the largest number of population living on our area, in our area. And it is really used by shipping traffic in the world. Okay, so. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope I don't bore you with a lot of this and maybe too many gym dandies, right? Show off of tables and so on. But this is what I like to do the Indonesian lecture, you see, on the Indonesian economy and the University of Indonesia, which is I'm still teaching up to now. After we discuss this, then for one semester we discuss about what kind of strategy can be used for palm oil, for rubber, for nickel, for copper in Freeport and so on. What about the prospect of LNG, which is good only for the next 80 years? What is going to be the prospect of coal, which is going to last for more than 100 years in Indonesia? So we can, after this, then we can, after understanding this business environment, then we can really move to the discussion of commodity by commodity, company by company, and so on. So that's what we do in the University of Indonesia. The reason why the name is Department of Economics and Business. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor.